HarperCollins presents The L Word, Love, Lust and Everything in Between by Aastha Atray Banan, read by Vasundhra Bose. Dedicated to all the listeners of Love Aaj Kal and Ankit, without whom these conversations would have never happened. Introduction. Ever since I started my podcast on love, Love Aaj Kal, I have realized two things. Love is a universal emotion. And two, also a universal problem. Young people and older are all wondering about how we find love, how we hang on to it, and how do we get by without it. And somehow, even when we truly know the do's and don'ts, as I truly believe, we are born with innate good sense and judgment. It's always good when someone spells it out for us. For example, I have learnt a lot from the best-selling book, The Secret, and I often remind myself of the teachings in the book. Believe, and you shall receive. The same way, I feel that when a relative stranger, aka me in this case, tells you some hard truths about love, you nod your head and say, yes, this makes sense. Maybe you won't follow the advice entirely, but just maybe you will remember it here and there and maybe make wiser choices. Or at least choices that hurt you less. Love is to be enjoyed and love is meant to be healthy. And love is meant to make you more you. Especially in 2021, we have realized that when life is so transient, do we have time to waste on bad love? No. A firm no. So, read on, and as I talk about all the common questions and dilemmas about it, maybe you will relate to it, and maybe you will find some solace and some direction. Maybe you will just store away the information for later use. Whatever it may be, what I do hope you take away from it is that love is meant for all of us. All we have to do is keep our hearts, minds, and souls open to it. And of course, make an effort. Best of luck, and may the love be with you. Lots of love. Aastha. Section 1. Virtually yours. Quote, dating has become a sport and not about finding the person you love. Unquote. Rashida Jones. Chapter 1. Take a swipe on me. As Harshad Mehta said in Scam 1992, risk mehi, ishq hai. When I was 21, the dating pool consisted of school friends, later college friends, then brothers of friends, friends of friends, and finally, when you finally started working, other interns who were slogging it out just like you. If you were fast, or promiscuous as it was called in those days, you had a fling or two with your 30-plus boss. Don't roll your eyes. It was 2002, and at that age, even the obviously unhappy, dysfunctional, dealing with his own demons older man looked exciting and sexy. But I am digressing. The year 2021 is a very different place to be if you are dating, trying to fall in love, or find someone who will be with you for the rest of your life, even till the end of the year might work. In the last few years, the game of love has changed ever since dating apps came trotting into town. It's now all at your fingertips. And let's face it, it is all about that hot picture, convenience of location, or the witty answer to some inane question like, dating me is like, or I am weirdly attracted to. It's only much later in life do you understand that compatibility is never about easy questions like this. But before we get that far, let's talk about the mad, toxic, exciting, sexy, insecure world of dating apps. Let me give you an example. I'm sitting with my two best friends from work and we are talking about their experiences on Tinder. These are an accumulation of the many, many experiences I've heard in the past few years. Take this. Girl swipes on boy. They indulge in some instant banter. Move to WhatsApp. Decide to meet. Great date. Sleep together on the first date. He even cuddles. Oh, how perfect of him. He spills his guts and tells girl about the fact that he is in therapy. Girl is overwhelmed with emotion. He must like me, she thinks. Boy texts 2 days later. His therapist has asked him not to sleep with the girl anymore and to end it, as he may like her too much. He is not ready for this mentally. Girl is angry, boy feels bad, and visits her and then sleeps with her again. But sorry, therapist's orders. And so, he's gone. This time, forever. When my friends and I sat down to talk about this guy, my first question was why he slept with her in the first place, since his therapist wanted him to focus on his life? Moreover, why was he even on dating apps? Good sense and experience made me believe he was lying to get out of subsequent dates. But maybe he also wanted to not look like a bad guy. He couldn't break up thinking my friend would believe he was a fuckboy. Instead, he wanted to vanish. What he did offer as an explanation was this. He couldn't keep away from my friend even though he was in therapy. And after he realized she was getting serious and conveyed that to his therapist, she told him to cool off before the girl got even more involved. That comes across as brutal. But maybe it's good it ended earlier than later. Let's take another example. Boy meets girl. Girl is hot. Girl and boy hook up. Best sex ever. But chemistry fizzles out. Girl and boy break up. Girl says she's totally fine with it. But girl now starts talking to boy's exes and friends and family. She's now best friends with everyone he knows. Boy doesn't know. One day, boy comes home and finds the girl at the reception. She just came by to say hi. Yes, sounds like your classic Hollywood stalker movie, but this is real life. Here's another example, and this is one of many DMs I received on Instagram. An 18-year-old met a guy on a dating app. They talk morning, night, and all the hours in between. He sends her a good morning text and a good night text. As the lockdown lifts, they make plans to meet on Friday amidst much excitement. On Thursday, she texts him to figure where they should have dinner. There is no answer. There is no answer on Friday. There is no answer on Saturday. There is no answer. Ever. Every experience is more bizarre than the next. But then, what does one do? Dating apps are the only legitimate place to meet anyone anymore. I think it's clear that even though we don't know why people behave the way they do online, heartbreaks happen all the time. Failed relationships or failed online meet-cutes hurt everyone. And perhaps it makes it even more important that we be more responsible. Yes, the anonymity helps. But can we leave people better than we found them? Especially in a world where we anyhow are slammed with everything that promises to break us. A lot has changed in the dating scene. It's not like in 2003 when I was sitting in Hawaiian Shack, a retro bar in Bombay's coolest suburb, Bandra, a time when people sent over drinks. Despite being an obvious overture of desire, it was all right if one didn't kiss them or sleep with them. But yes, you could have a lovely conversation with them. Of course, if you didn't like them, you could always gulp your drink down and tell them you had a curfew time. But then, you may get caught at the next bar which was open till 5 a.m. and bump into everybody from the previous bar over there. Ah, the good old days. But these days, why would anyone risk hurting their ego by asking someone out with a drink at a bar? Isn't it always better being rejected on a platform where no one else can see you wincing and crying? And so everyone and their ex is on the apps. Dating apps seem like a parallel world where singles and wannabe singles live in a continuous loop. People meet, insanely optimistic about where this could go, start getting panic attacks at even the first thing that goes wrong, and soon one ghosts the other. And we are back to the drawing board. What's baffling is, why instead of ghosting, they can't just tell you they are just not into you Why lead you on? Why say I love you to get sex? Why not be honest? Says a sweet friend of mine who just wants it straight. More on this very millennial concept of ghosting later. But then, as I think about it, most humans have never been good at being straight. It would take the drama out of life. And what's life without some drama? Sigh. But as an astute piece, The 5 Years That Changed Dating by Ashley Fetters in The Atlantic from 2018 said, many people getting married or engaged in these times met on a dating app. A Manhattan therapist to young couples actually commented that if he asked couples how they met, most of them looked at him like a fuddy-duddy. Their answer was always, on a dating app? How else does one meet? As of this year, according to a study by businessofapps.com, Tinder has 57 million users around the world. Bumble has 12.3 million users per month. And Badoo, not in India yet, is the largest in the dating app world with almost 500 million users. Sean Rad and Justin Mateen, two of Tinder's founders, have said in interviews that the inspiration for Tinder came from their own general dissatisfaction with the lack of dating opportunities in real life. Or, as Rad once said, Justin needed help meeting people because he had, what's that disorder you have where you don't leave the house? As Mateen said in the same Time magazine interview in 2014, nobody joins Tinder because they are looking for something. Rad went on to say, they join because they want to have fun. It doesn't even matter if you match because swiping is so fun. Or as one smart 25-year-old single man told me, dating apps haven't changed the game. They have just brought it closer home. Well, in the world we are now living, where a pandemic could strike us anytime, cloistering us in our homes, it would seem to say Justin's words were prophetic. What it goes to show could be that even though the way we look for a partner has changed, the need to find a sexual or emotional partner is the same. The challenges may be greater though, as now, along with the general menu of pros and cons a relationship has to go through, singles these days? As my co-podcaster on Love Aaj Kal, Ankit Vengurlikar, puts so succinctly, also have to deal with the illusion of choice. The fact that there is someone maybe more attractive, better suited to you emotionally, better in bed, all at the swipe of your finger. As 30-year-old journalist Prutha Bhosle, who has been on dating apps for 5 years now, says, but it makes sure we don't lose hope. If one thing doesn't work out, we can say, there are more fish in the sea. It keeps me hopeful. I can't meet people organically. My job gives me no time and I'm very comfortable in my circle of friends. So, how will it happen? On the apps, of course. Then she muses. But Ankit is right. Even if you meet someone you like, he may be ready to ghost you, as he is done and he has more choices. Jyotsna Mohan Bhargav has observed young people very closely, especially for her book, Stoned, Shamed, Depressed, The Secret Lives of India's Teens. I think it's very casual. But then again, when very young people are dating, casual is the key word. The problem is, it's all very transient, and millennials have lots of choices. They don't even have friends that last for years. How can they have relationships? They don't believe in working on things. It's all about moving on. Sometimes that's very good, sometimes bad. And this choice of plenty begets bad behavior. For Bhosle, the worst part about the apps is that since they know they can maybe find someone better, people don't put effort into their relationships. So you have to keep starting over. Every time, answer questions. Where did you go to school? What do you like eating? Blah, blah. It's like an interview. It gets superbly monotonous. But, as Harry Rees, PhD professor of psychology and Dean's professor in arts, sciences and engineering at the University of Rochester, said in a paper he wrote on online dating, there's the old saying that you have to kiss a lot of frogs to find a prince. And I think that really applies to online dating. And so, there goes the one big advantage. The dating pool is almost as large as the sea itself that you look for plenty of fish in. So, since we are living life on the apps, Why not make sense of it? And why not take inspiration from people who have met on the apps and landed up married, or even better, in a fulfilling relationship that requires no labels? Yes, it's a utopian world, but if we don't imagine it, who will? First things first, be clear about why you logged on. The two 30-year-olds I spoke to, a man and a woman, both said that the best thing about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.